Hello and welcome to the CNN IBN special. The Anna Hazare anti-corruption movement has thrown up multiple voices. Many have been supportive of the movement, but there have been some who have been skeptical and raised doubts about the movement as well. One of those skeptical voices is writer Arundhati Roy, who now joins us. Thanks very much indeed for joining us. In your article in The Hindu, published on 21st August, entitled "I'd Rather Not Be Anna," you've raised many doubts about the Anna Hazare campaign. Now that the movement is over and the crowds have come and we've seen the massive size of those crowds, do you continue to be skeptical, and if so, why?
Well, it's interesting that everybody seems to have gone away happy and everybody is claiming a massive victory. I'm kind of happy too, relieved, I'd say, mostly because I'm extremely glad that the Jan Lokpal Bill didn't go through Parliament in its current form. Yes, I'm very skeptical. I continue to be skeptical for a whole number of reasons. Primary among them, the legislation itself, which I think is a pretty dangerous piece of work. So what you had was this very general mobilization about corruption, using people's anger, very real and valid anger against the system, to push through this very specific legislation, or to attempt to push through this very specific piece of legislation, which is very, very regressive, according to me. But my skepticism, ranges through a whole host of issues, which has to do with, history, politics, culture, symbolism, all of it made me extremely uncomfortable. And I also thought that, it had the potential to turn from something inclusive, or what was being marketed or touted as being inclusive, to something very divisive and dangerous. So I'm quite happy that it's over for now.
Just to come back to your article, you've said that Arvind Kejriwal and Manish Sisodia have received $400,000 from the Ford Foundation. That was one of the reasons why you were skeptical about this movement. Why did you make it a point to put in the fact that Arvind Kejriwal is funded by the Ford Foundation?
See, I think just in order to point to the fact, in a short article you can just indicate the fact that it is in some ways an NGO-driven movement. I mean, Kiran Bedi, Arvind Kejriwal, Sisodia, all these people run NGOs. Three of the core members are Magsaysay Award winners, which is endowed by Ford Foundation and Rockefeller. And I wanted to point to the fact that what is it about these NGOs funded by World Bank or Ford and so on? Why are they participating in sort of mediating what public policy should be? I actually went to the World Bank site recently and found that the World Bank runs 600 anti-corruption programs just in, places like sub-Saharan Africa. Why is the World Bank that interested in anti-corruption? I looked at five of the major points they made, and I thought it was remarkable, if you let me read them out. One, increasing political accountability. Two, strengthening civil society participation. Three, creating a competitive private sector. Four, instituting restraints on power. Five, improving public sector management. So it explained to me why in this World Bank, Ford Foundation, these people are all involved in increasing the penetration of international capital. And so it explains why, at a time when we are all so worried about corruption, the major parts of what corruption meant in terms of corporate corruption, in terms of how NGOs and corporations are taking over the traditional functions of government, but that whole thing was left out. And this is copybook World Bank agenda. They may not have meant it, but that's what's going on, and it worries me a lot. It wasn't some, certainly Anna Hazare was picked up and propped up as the sort of saint of the masses, but he wasn't driving the movement. He wasn't the brains behind the movement. And I think this is something very pertinent that we really need to worry about. It's not the same thing as a people's movement that's risen from the bottom. It's very much something that surely lots of people joined it. All of them were not BJP, all of them were not middle class. Many of them came to a sort of reality show that was orchestrated by even a very campaigning media. But what was this bill about? you know, this bill was very, very worrying to me.
Just to re-emphasize the point about Medha Patkar and Prashant Bhushan, these are old-time associates of yours in activism, and they're deeply involved in this particular movement. How do you react to them being involved in this movement of which you're so critical?
Well, with some dismay, because I mean, Prashant is a very close friend of mine and I respect Medha a lot. But I think that their credibility has been cashed in some ways, but I feel badly that they are part of it.
You said both the Maoists and the Jan Lokpal Bill movement have one thing in common. They both seek the overthrow of the Indian state. Why do you believe that the movement for the Jan Lokpal Bill is similar to the Maoist movement in seeking the overthrow of the Indian state?
Well, let's separate the movement from the bill. As I said, I don't even believe that most people knew exactly what the provisions of the bill were, who were part of the movement, very few in the media and on the ground. But if you study that bill carefully, you see the creation of a parallel oligarchy. You see that the Jan Lokpal itself, the bench, you know, the 10 people plus the chairman, they are selected by a pool of very elite people, and they are an elite people. I mean, if you look at one of the phases, it says the search committee, which is the committee that's going to shortlist the names of the people who will be chosen for the Jan Lokpal, will shortlist from eminent individuals or such class of people whom they deem fit. So you create this panel from this pool, and then you start, you have a bureaucracy which has policing powers, the power to tap your phones, the power to prosecute, the power to transfer, the power to judge, the power to do things which are really, and from the Prime Minister down to the bottom, it's really like a parallel power which has lost the accountability, or whatever little accountability a representative government might have. But I'm not one of those who's critiquing it from the point of view of, say, someone like Aruna Roy or Nikhil, who have a less draconian version of the bill. I mean, I'm talking about it from a different point of view altogether, of firstly the fact that we need to define what do we mean by corruption, and then what does it mean to those who are disempowered and disenfranchised to have two oligarchies instead of one reigning over them.
And you believe that the reason why this movement is misconceived is because it's centered around this Jan Lokpal Bill.
Can we at least discuss what we mean by corruption? Is it just financial irregularity, or is it the currency of social transaction in a very unequal society? Some people, poor people in villages, have to pay bribes to get their ration cards, to get their NREGA dues from very powerful vested interests. Then you have a middle class, you have honest businessmen who cannot run an honest business because of all sorts of reasons. They are out there angry. You have a middle class which actually bribes to buy itself scarce favors. And on the top you have the corporations, the politicians looting millions in mines and so on. But you also have a huge number of people who are outside the legal framework, because they don't have pattas, because they live in slums, they don't have legal housing, they are selling their wares on raids. So they are illegal. And in an anti-corruption law is naturally sort of pinned to an accepted legality. So you can talk about the rule of law when all your laws are designed to perpetuate the inequality that exists in Indian society. If you're not going to question that, you know, I'm really not someone who's that interested in the debate then.
But just to come back to the movement again, don't you think that the political class has become corrupted and has become venal? And when you have a movement like this, it does function as a wake-up call?
To some extent, yes. But I think by focusing on the political class and leaving out the corporations, the media that they own, the NGOs that are taking over functions, governmental functions like health, and you know, corporates are now dealing with what governments used to deal with. Why are they left out? You know, so I think a much more comprehensive view would have made me comfortable, even though I keep saying that for me the real issue is what is it that has created a society in which 830 million people live on less than 20 rupees a day, and you have more poor people than all of the poor countries of Africa put together.
So basically what you're saying is that it's not the battle against corruption which is the primary battle, it's the battle for justice that has to be the primary battle in India. Let's take a short break and come back. Welcome back to the CNNIBN special. We're talking to Arundhati Roy about why she's skeptical about the Anna Hazare anti-corruption movement. We were talking about lawmaking and why laws are not enough, but just to come back to the point about the law, many have said that this is a process of pre-legislative consultation, that all over the world now, civil society groups, I know you don't like that word, are cooperating with the government in lawmaking. And this movement, a movement like this, institutionalizes that. It institutionalizes civil society groups coming into the lawmaking process. Doesn't that make you hopeful about this movement?
Well, in principle, yes. But when a movement like this, which has been constructed in the way that it has, which we can talk about, sort of calls itself the people or civil society and says that it's representing all of civil society, I would say there's a problem there.
Let's talk about the media. You've been very critical about the media and the way the media, particularly broadcast media, has covered this movement. Do you believe that if the media had not given it this kind of time, this movement simply wouldn't have taken off? Do you believe it's a media manufactured movement?
Well, I'm not going to say it's entirely media manufactured. I think that was one of the big factors in it. There was also mobilization from the BJP and the RSS, which they have admitted to. I think the media, you know, I don't know when before it has campaigned for something in this way, where every other kind of news was pushed out, and for 10 days you had only this news. In this nation of 1 billion people, the media didn't find anything else to report, and it campaigned. I'm not everybody, but certainly certain major television channels campaigned and said they were campaigning. They said, we are the channel through whom Anna speaks to the people, and so on. Now, firstly, to me, that's a form of corruption in the first place, where presumably a broadcast license as a news channel has to do with reporting news, not campaigning. But even if you are campaigning, and the only reason that everybody was reporting it was TRP ratings, then why not just, you know, settle for pornography or sadomasochism or whatever gives good TRP ratings? You know, how can news channels just abandon every other piece of news and just concentrate on this for 10 days? I mean, you know how much a spot ad costs on TV. What kind of a price would you put on this? And why was it doing it? Per se, if media campaigns had to do with social justice, if the media spent 10 days campaigning on why, you know, more than 1 lakh farmers have committed suicide in this country, I'd be glad, because I would say, okay, this is the job of the media, to the old saying, you know, to afflict the comfortable and to comfort
afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. But don't you think one man taking on the might of the government is a big story, and don't you think that that deserves to be covered?
No, I don't, because I mean for all the sorts of reasons I've said, it was one man trying to push through a regressive piece of legislation.
Let's come to the role of the RSS, which you have also alluded to. You've spoken about the role of aggressive nationalism, of Vande Mataram being chanted, of the RSS saying that we are involved in this particular movement. But then your old associates, Prashant Bhushan and Medha Patkar, are in this movement as well. Is it fair to completely dub this movement as an RSS Hindu right-wing movement?
Well, I haven't done that, though some people have. But I think it's an interesting question to talk about symbolism, you know, and this movement. For example, what is the history of Vande Mataram? You know, Vande Mataram first occurred in this book by Bankim Chandra Chatterjee in 1882. It became a part of the sort of war cry at the time of the partition of Bengal, and since then, you know, since in 1937, Tagore said it's a very unsuitable national anthem, very divisive. It's got a long history, a long communal history. So what does it mean when huge crowds are chanting that? When you take up the national flag, when you're fighting colonialism, it means one thing. When you're a supposedly free nation, that national flag is always about exclusion and not inclusion. You took up that flag and the state was paralyzed. A state which is not scared of slaughtering people in the dark suddenly was paralyzed. You know, you talk about the fact it was a non-violent movement. Yes, because the police were disarmed. They just were too scared to do anything. You had Bharat Mata ka photo first, and then it was replaced by Gandhi. You had people who were openly part of the Manuvadi Krantikari Andolan there. So, you know, you had this cocktail of very dangerous things going on. You had other kinds of symbolism. You know, imagine Gandhi going to a private hospital after his fast, a private hospital that symbolizes the withdrawal of the state from healthcare for the poor, a private hospital where the doctors charge a lakh every time they inhale and exhale. You know, the symbolisms were dangerous, and if this movement had not ended in this way, it could have turned extremely dangerous.
But weren't you impressed by the sheer size of the crowds? Weren't you impressed by the spontaneity of the crowds?
Shall I tell you something, Sagarika? I have seen much larger crowds in Kashmir. I have seen much larger crowds even in Delhi. Nobody reported them. They were then only called traffic jam bana diya inhone, you know. I was not impressed by the size of the crowds, apart from the fact that I'm not that kind of person. You know, I'm sure there were larger crowds chanting for the demolition of the Babri Masjid. You know, would that be fine by us? It's not about numbers.
But what about the persona of Anna Hazare? You know, many would say he evoked a certain different era. He evoked the era of the freedom struggle. He's a simple Gandhian. He does lead a very austere life. He lives in a small room behind a temple. And his persona, or what he is, evokes a certain moral power, perhaps, which is needed in an India which is facing a moral crisis.
Well, I think, you know, Anna Hazare was a sort of empty vessel into which you could pour whatever meaning you wanted to pour in, you know. Unlike someone like Gandhi, who was very much his own man on the stage of the world, Anna Hazare is certainly his own man in his village, but here he was not in charge of what was going on. That was very evident, you know. And as for who he is and what his affiliations and antecedents have been, again, I'm worried.
What do you think of the fast unto death? Many have criticized it as a brahmastra which shouldn't be easily deployed in political agitations, that Gandhi used it only as a last resort. What is your view of the hunger strike, the fast unto death?
I mean, I'm not interested in a fast unto death for the Jan Lokpal Bill, frankly. I am going on and on in all the 10 years that I've written about nuclear power, about nuclear bombs, about big dams, about this particular model of development, about displacement, about land acquisition, about mining, about privatization. These are the things I want to talk about. I'm not the doctor to tell the Indian state how to improve itself, you know.
And this movement has done nothing to touch that. What precedent has it set for protest movements in the future?
Well, for protest movements of the powerful, protest movements where the media is on your side, protest movements where the government is scared of you, protest movements where the police disarm themselves. How many movements are there going to be like that, you know? I don't know. I mean, while you're talking about this, the army is getting ready to move into central India to fight the poorest people in this country, and I can tell you they're not disarmed, you know. So I don't know what lessons you can draw from a protest movement that has privileges that no other protest movement I've ever known has had.
So it was a protest movement of the entitled and a protest movement of the privileged. Arundhati Roy, thanks very much indeed for joining us.
Which has to do with, you know, history, politics, culture, symbolism, all of it made me extremely uncomfortable. And I also thought that, you know, it had the potential to turn from something inclusive or what was being marketed or touted as being inclusive to something very divisive and dangerous. So I'm quite happy that it's over for now.
Just to come back to your article, you said that Arvind Kejriwal and Manish Sisodia have received $400,000.
For a whole number of reasons, primary among them the legislation itself, which I think is a pretty dangerous piece of work. So what you had was this very general mobilization about corruption, using people's anger, very real and valid anger against the system, to push through this very specific legislation, or to attempt to push through this very specific piece of legislation, which is very, very regressive, according to me. But my skepticism, ranges through a whole host of issues.
From the Ford Foundation. That was one of the reasons why you were skeptical about this movement. Why did you make it a point to put in the fact that Arvind Kejriwal is funded by the Ford Foundation?
See, I think just in order to point to the fact, I mean, in a short article, you can just indicate the fact that it is in some ways an NGO-driven movement. I mean, Kiran Bedi, Arvind Kejriwal, Sisodia, all these people run NGOs, three of
the Anna Hazare campaign. Now that the movement is over and the crowds have come and we've seen the massive size of those crowds, do you continue to be skeptical, and if so, why?
Well, it's interesting that everybody seems to have gone away happy and everybody's claiming a massive victory. I'm kind of happy too, relieved, I'd say, mostly because I'm extremely glad that the Jan Lokpal Bill didn't go through Parliament in its current form. Yes, I'm very skeptical. I continue to be skeptical.
Hello and welcome to the CNN IBN special. The Anna Hazare anti-corruption movement has thrown up multiple voices. Many have been supportive of the movement, but there have been some who have been skeptical and raised doubts about the movement as well. One of those skeptical voices is writer Arundhati Roy, who now joins us. Thanks very much indeed for joining us. In your article in The Hindu, published on 21st August, entitled I'd Rather Not Be Anna, you've raised many doubts about